بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين
And one of the interesting things about Hajj is that it's the only one there. It's called Arafat, which means, Arafat means in the Arabic language, really it comes from a word which means to know. And some say that the reason the Arafat, the day of Arafat is because it's on a plain, a great huge plain, and it's where the first male and female are parents, Adam and Hawa, where they met and re-emerged into the world with this knowledge of each other. And some say that it's because the nature of Hajj itself and the day of Arafat is actually a deep knowledge and awareness of our Lord. But it's interesting that that day is that one day, and if you miss it, you miss Hajj. And it used to quite literally take people sometimes more than a year to make it on the journey of Hajj. They would have to go, for instance, from Morocco, and there was a caravan, and in the Mauritanian desert in West Africa, they would have to go to the city of Shingrit, and then from Shingrit, they would take a caravan up to Marrakesh, and in Marrakesh, they would meet the caravan of Hajj, and they would go across continent, quite literally across the continent of Africa, to go on Hajj. And if they missed Arafat, they missed Hajj. But it wasn't a problem, because they would just stay in Mecca for a year until the next Hajj. And those were the good old days, when people didn't have to get back to work. See, now they go to Hajj, and they can't stay and enjoy themselves because they have to get back to work. Well, in those days, people literally took care of their life so that if they didn't come back from the journey, no one would be shocked. In other words, it was literally considered a preparation for death. And it is really an exercise, it is a spiritual exercise to prepare one for death itself. And the symbolism of the Hajj itself is the symbolism of the unseen world. The movement, let me just go through first. The Quran says that God has made the house, this place in Mecca, the base, which is a house, with a base of masaba to the man, that he made it a masaba for humankind. And what masaba means is it is a place that you return to again and again. It's a place that you return to. It's also, it comes from a root word, saba, yasubu, which means to return to. And when the Arabs, they say saba ila nafsihi, it means he returned to consciousness. After being unawake or unaware, he returned to consciousness. And so part of the actual process of what's happening is a spiritual awakening that takes place. And the word in Arabic, hajj, is related to a word which means truth. And one of the experiences of going to Mecca is to recognize the clear truth of the Deen of Islam. It's a confirmation of everything that one has believed, and it's an awakening of that belief in its deepest and most profound sense. Several things are confirmed in the Hajj itself. The first confirmation is that the house was purified for God alone, not to be associated with anything. And this is a house that was filled with idols before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him, purified it from the rizq, from the foulness of idolatry. Now, it's interesting that in modern times, and particularly in California and the neo-pagan movements that are taking place now in the world, is a revival and a celebration of paganism and idolatry. This is one of the signs of modern Western sophistication, is that now we can appreciate idolatry. It's no longer seen as Christianity saw it as something that was foul, but not as something to really celebrate. And there's interesting books written about idolatry that it is really, to the contrary of monotheism, which is intolerant, is a tolerant way of life, because you accept everybody's idol. And it, from a Muslim point of view, it's rather sad, because part of the purpose of Islam is literally to raise people out of superstition, to take them away from the superstition of their own fears and insecurities. And idolatry, in all of its forms, and certainly we, although many of us in the world no longer worship idols of stone and wood and these type of things, in the Quran there are actually three types of idols mentioned. One is called a sonar, and another is called Ratan, and another is called Timsan. These are the three types of idols that the Quran actually mentions. The first one, the sonar, is something that has no use or benefit at all. It's just empty. And anything that has no benefit whatsoever is a sonar, a piece of wood that people worship, something like that. The next one, which is Ratan, is a conceptualization. In other words, it's an interiorization of the sonar. It's how the worshiper himself understands what he's worshiping. So in other words, the sonar is literally the object itself, but the ratan is the perception of the worshiper. It's his interior understanding of this thing that he's worshiping, and therefore the ratan is the internal idol. It's the idol that one carries inside, and this is irrespective of whether a person is actually worshiping some wooden thing. In other words, the ideal of human beings, the idea of country is an idol. Nationalism becomes an idol. And it's actually quite a dangerous idol, because it oftentimes results in mass destruction and death of people who fight in the name of the idol of nationalism. The idol of the self, which is really one of the greatest idols, if not the greatest idol itself, the idol of the self, that the human being is somehow in a state of independence, you see. The illusion or the delusion that one carries about him or her own self. And then the last one is called a kimsad. And this is the actual image. It's the image itself. It's a representation. Now, because the nature of monotheism is literally to take people to the highest abstraction, which is a recognition of the unity of God without any conceptualization whatsoever. In other words, God is not a concept, and God is not amenable to conceptualization. We cannot conceive of God. And this is something that is foundational to Islamic monotheism, that we literally give up all concepts of God when we become a Muslim. And we do not say anything about God other than what we believe that God says about God's own reality, which is the description of the divinity in the Quran itself. So there is no name which we apply to God other than names that God has applied to the divinity. And this is really the starting place of Islamic monotheism. When we say La ilaha illallah, We are literally freeing ourselves from any conceptualization of God. Literally, it is no concept. When we say La ilaha illallah, we give up conceptualization of God and recognize that the human intellect, in its finite nature, is incapable of encompassing the infinite. That the finite cannot contain the infinite by the very nature of the finite reality of the intellect itself. It is limited, it has limits. And its limits are vast and expansive. There's estimated more cells in the human brain than there are cells in the universe. So, I mean, it's an extraordinary thing, the brain itself. But we recognize that the brain is limited, and it cannot conceive of the limitless. And therefore, the fundamental act of worshiping Islam is to put one's intellect on the ground. It is literally to put the intellect on the ground and to submit one's intellect, not giving it up, but putting it into a state of submission. It is in no way giving the intellect up. So Islam is not a religion of superstition. In fact, it rejects the whole superstitious idea of religion, that man is, or woman is meant to worship something of which they're simply worshiping out of a state of fear or out of a state of insecurity. This whole concept of religion is rejected in Islam. That the fundamental reason that we worship is because, one, a recognition of the human need to worship. There is a fundamental need for the human being. We believe that God is literally beyond need of worship, but we are in need of worship, and we believe that it is essential to our nature to worship. It is not something accidental. It's not something that can be separated from the essential nature of the human being. So we believe quite literally that the human being is designed to worship. Now, if you look up in an old English dictionary, you will find that worship, in its root meaning, meant to prostrate. And this is the primal way in which the human being worships. And you'll find this in the Bible. You'll find the description of the prophet. It will say, and then he fell on his face. Abraham fell on his face. Jesus, in the New Testament, he fell on his face. Well, in Hebrew, it would be similar to in Arabic what's called Kharat Ajida. That he literally fell down prostrate, you see, and that's what it means. So what is happening in our movement towards the house of God, which is the Baytullah, the Kaaba itself, this cube that is in the Arabian Peninsula, literally in the middle of the city of Mecca, that we face this empty house, and it is an empty house. And that emptiness symbolizes our inability to conceptualize the divine. That we literally place no idols in that house. It is an empty house, void of all forms and images. There is no timsah, there is no representation there. And this is why one of our greatest, in fact, after the Prophet ﷺ, we consider him the greatest of the Muslims, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, who said, Al-'ajzu 'an idrakihi idraku. Our inability to know God is our knowledge of God. That is, the knowledge that the Muslim has of God is his inability to know God, which is actually it's actually late 19th century existentialist thought. Kind of gets to that. That's where Kierkegaard, famous Danish philosopher, realized that the knowledge of God was actually impossible, and therefore submission to God is a recognition of that impossibility or incomprehensibility of God. And so what happens is the freeing of the human being from idols is essential to understanding what Mecca is and what the Kaaba itself is. It is literally the symbol of the liberation of the human being, and this is why it's called Beit al-Atiq. And Beit al-Atiq is the house that liberates. It's the house that liberates. It in Arabic means to liberate, to free. And so it is the house that frees human beings of any concept that will put them into a state of superstition or submission to other than what is true. And this is why the Prophet, peace be upon him, he said, Allahumma arini al-ashya kama hiya. Oh Allah, show me things as they truly are. Show me things as they truly are. And so really, what submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, the only thing one loses when submitting to Allah is their own delusion. This is the only thing that the human being loses when they submit to God, is their delusion, is their own miscomprehension or misperception of reality. This is the only thing that one loses, because in reality, all of humankind and all of the heavens and the earth are in a state of submission to God. In reality. Everything is in a state of submission to God. And so what the Hajj is, it is the human recognition that we are in a state of submission to God, and that we must put as our priority in life a direction which is God-centered. It's theocentric by nature. This is the direction of the human life should be theocentric. It should not be egocentric. It should be theocentric. It should be based on having God as one's direction in life. And what this does is that it enables human beings to transcend the mundane, to literally rise above the worldly level and enter into the realm of both pure worship and pure service. Because ultimately worship is service. And this is why, related to the house, and this is one of the beautiful aspects of this teaching, is that you will not find any act of worship that is not directly related to some social element. So So in the Quran it says, in Surah Al-Hajj, which is the Surah of the Pilgrimage, وَأَذِنْ فِي النَّاسِ الْحَجِّ, and proclaim to humankind that the pilgrimage, the Hajj. And then it says, يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالَ وَعَلَى كُلِّ ضَامِرٍ, they will come to you on foot and with every lean animal. They will come to you from every deep and distant wide mountain highway to perform the Hajj. And then it says, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ, in order to witness things that are beneficial for them. Now the traditional interpretation of this verse is that there's worldly gain in the Hajj. In other words, that people can go for tijara, they can go and literally buy and sell, and many people traditionally would take wares to the Hajj and they would carry them with them on their animal and they would sell them when they got the Hajj. So there's an idea of worldly gain as well, and this is the Islamic ideal of balancing between the worldly aspect of the human need and the other worldly aspect. They're never separate. And so you will see always in the Islamic teaching that there's a balance between our worldly needs and our other worldly needs, that the human being is both body and soul. And in a sense, they're inseparable. And this is why there's no separation in Islam between the worldly important matters and the other worldly matters of importance. So it says that they may witness things that are benefits of them, which has to do with reward of the Hajj, of the Akhirah, but also of worldly benefits. And then, وَيَذْكُرُ إِسْمُ اللَّهِ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ, and to remember the name of Allah. And this is one of the important things also, يَذْكُرُ إِسْمُ اللَّهِ, which is the name of Allah, which is only symbolic of the reality of Allah, which is unknowable to the human being. And so this is, again, in emphasizing the pure transcendent element or aspect of the human being's understanding of God, that which is beyond conceptualization. See, أيام المعلومات, in these known days, على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام, and to mention these names on these days, over the beasts that Allah has provided for them, and this is again the worldly, the human being bringing the worldly to the place of the otherworldly and symbolically sacrificing the worldly for the otherworldly. And so human beings are encouraged on the Hajj to literally sacrifice an animal, and this sacrifice is again a sacrifice that transcends superstition. It is not about any need of God to propitiate the gods or something like this. No, it is a sacrifice that is based on the recognition of the importance of sacrificing the worldly for the otherworldly, that it is necessary. And doing that, there is benefit for human beings. And this is why immediately after that it says, فَكُلُوا مِنْهَا وَأَطْعِمُوا الْبَائِسَ الْفَقِيرَ, eat from it yourselves. In other words, in your own sacrifice is benefit for you, and feed the less fortunate. So immediately there's a tie again to the importance of social responsibility. But the Hajj itself says that there's a benefit for you, but don't forget those less fortunate than you. And part of the symbolism of going on Hajj is literally seeing humanity in its stripped away nature. When you go on Hajj, what you literally see is humanity with all of their faults exposed before you. And you can choose to look and concentrate on those faults, or you can choose to recognize that you, like them, are in the midst of this human creature so filled with frailty and human naqs, deficiency. But this is a recognition of the deep humanity that has to arise in the human being in order for us to live as human communities together. And so Hajj is literally a recognition of this bonding of human beings together. And this is why for 1400 years, the Prophet ﷺ reestablished this ancient rite, which is, we believe, Abrahamic, going back to the father of the monotheistic tradition, Abraham, that he established the rites of the Hajj, and the Prophet ﷺ purified them and reformulated them for the last stage of human life on earth. And so the person who goes on the Hajj is literally moving to the house of God from the dunya, from this realm of the mundane to the realm of the supermundane, of that which literally goes beyond the world, and enters into an otherworldly place. Mecca is quite literally otherworldly, and anybody who's ever entered into the haram knows exactly what I'm talking about. When you enter into the haram, you enter into a realm that is no longer part of the world. It's literally quite outside of the world. And I can guarantee you have to experience this. And those of you that have been blessed with this experience really understand exactly what I'm talking about. But this is like, it's what Imam al-Ghazali would call a low-key knowledge, a knowledge of taste. It's not a knowledge that can be articulated like the taste of honey or the sweetness of intimacy between a man and a woman. These things cannot be articulated on the tongue. They have to be experienced by the individual. And this is part of the power of the Kaaba itself, is entering into the jadal, or the magnetic nature of the Kaaba, which Ibrahim alayhi salam said, he asked God to make the heart of some of humanity, some of humanity to incline towards this house, that their hearts literally incline towards it. And so each year, all over the world, people prepare to make this journey to Mecca, to the house of God. And there are people from every color, from every tongue, from the male and the female, from literally every human inhabited place on the earth, people set out. You see in the house, you see people from White Russia, you see people from the Caucasus Mountains, you see people from China, you see people from Indonesia, from Philippines, from Japan, you see people from the United States, you see people from Canada, from South America, you see people from every continent and every country in the world, represented symbolically as one humanity. And this is literally the realm that transcends nationalism. It is to see the vision of human beings like the one who sees the earth from the moon. You see, once you've seen the earth from the moon, the boundaries that men divide their worlds by suddenly dissipate and no longer have any importance or meaning. And this is part of the experience of literally going to Hajj, is recognizing that human boundaries themselves are the illusions that we set up, that God has not placed those boundaries on us. We have placed those boundaries on ourselves. That God has made us from one self, and from that self made its opposite, and from the opposites made all of humankind. And this is the recognition that takes place in the house of Allah. And so we go literally into Mecca into a state of ihram. And the state of ihram is to enter into a state of sanctity. It comes from the word haram or haram, which means sanctity, to be in an inviolable state. And the human being enters into his birthright, which is inviolability. But the nafs itself is inviolable. And yet outside of Mecca, the nature of human beings is that they violate the dignity and the sanctity of the self. In Mecca, this is absolutely prohibited. And this is why it says in the Quran that God has made it a place of amn, amna, which means security. Everyone is equal in this place, the one coming from the far place and the one who lives there himself. And so even the Meccan is the same as the one who's distant. In other words, the one who is native to that city has no more right to that city than the one coming from the most distant place. And this is literally to break down the diseases of provincialism, of tribalism, of nationalism. That we have to transcend these things that are divisive, these things that literally create this antagonism between human beings. And we enter into a realm that is literally a recognition of our common bond as human beings, of our common humanity. And so we enter into this place saying, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. And this means, at your service, I'm answering the call. I am answering the call. But this is a call. وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ لِمَنَ اسْتَطَعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. That God has a right upon humankind that they make a pilgrimage to his house. And this is an invitation. It's literally a da'wah. It's a da'wah, which means an invitation. It is God's invitation to his house, to all of humankind. And it's an open invitation to anyone who wants to enter into that house. This is an open invitation from the creator of the heavens and the earth to human society. Enter into my house. Enter in peace, in a state of tranquility and security. And if we choose to accept that call, then we enter into what's called a state of Islam or submission to God, which should not be in any way, for those of you who are not Muslim, should not be in any way associated with the state religion of the so-called Muslim world. When I say Islam, I'm not talking in any way about the religion of the constitution of Egypt, or the religion of the constitution of Saudi Arabia, or the religion of the constitution of Indonesia, or wherever. That is not the Islam I'm talking about. That's another Islam. Just unfortunately has the same name, and people get them confused. And unfortunately there's a lot of people that call themselves Muslim also that have the same name as these other people, and people get them confused as well. So this is the unfortunate nature of the equivocality of language. You can have the same words and mean very different things. So when I say Islam, I'm talking about this primordial state of being, which is a state of submission to God, which is it really is pre-religious. It is pre-religious. It is not part of religion, but religion is really an unfortunate appellate that has been given to Islam, and it does not befit Islam, because Islam is a pre-religious understanding. Religion, and I'm talking about the whole idea of the institutionalization, the ritualization of a contract between the human being and between his or her creator, his or her object of worship. And so you enter into the state of sanctity, and you enter into the city saying, Labbaik, I am at your service. And you come to the house, and you enter into this house in a state of purity. And then you literally circumambulate the house, which means to walk around it, seven times. And seven is an important number in all cosmology, all over the world, whether it's Christianity, Judaism, all over the world, seven is a very important number, and it deals literally with cycles. Human beings tend to fall into cycles of seven. The first 7 years are a distinct stage in atomic cosmology, and then the next 7 years are a distinct stage, and then the next 7 years, and so on. And so one... So one enters into the Kaaba, and then walks around this house. Walks around the house, which... There is an element there that is literally beyond the rational. I mean, if one started entering into the logical left brain mode, as they say, it would really seem to be a very odd thing to do. But if one literally enters in and admits to the Hajj itself, to the experience itself, then one enters into the flood of humanity, which is literally by its nature theocentric. And this is the movement around the house of God, this empty house in which all of humanity enters into this river or current of motion, and does that for seven times. And some of them say that each representing the seven cycles of man, because there are actually seven stages of human life, beginning with infancy and ending with old age and death. And then one goes to what's called Safa and Marwa. Now this is very important, because Safa is related to the idea of purity, and Marwa is related to the place of where thirst is quenched. Now, I want to talk a little bit about this idea. We are living in the 20th century, almost on the verge of the 21st century, or the 15th, almost. We're actually just entered into the 15th Islamic century. So people often like to point out that the Muslims want to go back to the Middle Ages. Well, we already are in the Middle Ages for us. So, going between Safa and Marwa, the idea in the 21st century is that there has been a declaration of what's known as the Grand Narrative, which is called the death of the Grand Narrative, and this is called the postmodern world. And if you get into where the cutting edge of philosophy is that they're basically saying there are no longer grand narratives for us to live our lives by. This is where 20th century man and woman is that there's really nothing to believe in anymore in this grand sense. But what we're left with is these small narratives that if we believe in it, it's truth with a small t, not truth with a big T. And we recognize that we're in a world of multiple small t truths. There is no big T truth left. Now the word which Leotard uses in his book on knowledge and the postmodern condition is grand narrative. That really the postmodern man and woman, the kitwa was traditionally changed every year, and it was the Egyptians made the kitwa, and then it was carried from Assyria to the Kaaba. And during the time of Jamal Abdel Nasser, when there was political strife between the two countries, the Saudis actually stopped importing the kitwa from Egypt. And it's part of the disease of nationalism that has entered into the Muslim cultures. And they actually began to produce the kitwa themselves. Now, traditionally, the kitwa was cut up and given out. And it was traditionally given out to the people that went on the Hajj. It was just, if you happen to be there, I had a man who was from Italy who became Muslim. He was, now they let dignitaries into the Kaaba in this state religion called Islam, not to be confused with the religion of Ibrahim and the Prophet Muhammad called Islam. But in that state religion, they actually let these so-called dignitaries, who I don't know what dignity they have, really it's not a good title for these people, because a lot of them are actually just thugs. They're the people that have been most brutal in their own societies, and that's how they've gotten into power. I mean, quite this is like killing people and smashing heads in. In fact, in some countries, that's actually the quickest rise to power in whatever the state apparatus is the one who's actually the most vicious, who can kill people without batting an eyelid, so to speak. The present ruler of Iraq is noted for his viciousness. So to call them dignitaries really is, I think we would actually, it would be easier to call a dog a dignitary than a lot of these people. And even to compare them to dogs would be, I think, quite inappropriate because dogs are just acting their dogginess. They're not being other than a dog, and you can't blame a dog for being a dog, but you can certainly blame a human being for behaving less than an animal. But this Italian man who was making his pilgrimage happened to be a little too close to the Libyan delegation, and they were letting him into the Kaaba, and he got pushed in to the Kaaba with the delegation. They thought he was part of the Libyan delegation, and he didn't have any problem with that. So he actually went into the Kaaba, and actually the Prophet did initially want to make the Kaaba open for people to go inside of it. But he changed that, and so traditionally people did not go inside of it. But there, it is permissible to go into the Kaaba, and if one does, one is not supposed to look up, according to the tradition, to the roof of the Kaaba. And we believe in what's called the Bayt al-Ma'mur, which is the ancient house, which is the, I don't want to use platonic terms, but it's actually the ideal house of which the Kaaba, in a sense, is a prototype of on the earth. And that ancient, the Bayt al-Ma'mur, there is a connection between the two houses. And so it's as if there's a floodgate of light coming down upon that house. So it's actually, it's a very, again, if you're there and if you're at the Muntazam, it's a very powerful place to be and something to experience. So the Kaaba was cut into pieces and given out, and now it's done for these so-called dignitaries to put on their walls in their offices or something like that, symbolic of their adherence to the state religion called Islam, not to be confused with Islam. Any other?
I believe the non-Muslims are not supposed to, or they're not permitted to go to Mecca and Medina. Is this from the ancient times that this something that happened?
No, the both Mecca and Medina are considered a sanctuary, and the Prophet did the Quran actually says that the people of Shirk were not to come into the vicinity of the house after the year that they were given that period. And so they had the choice. Some of them actually left the Arabian Peninsula, and they had the choice to either leave or become Muslim. And that is because, in a sense, like a bird sanctuary, where you can't actually shoot or hunt birds, because it's a purified place. It's a sanctuary for birds to live. The Mecca and Medina are seen as places for people who are in following this primordial deen and in a state of submission to God, as a place in which there is not to be a mixture of other teachings. Now this naturally does not in any way indicate that this is not true of other Muslim places. Christians, Jews, and idol worshippers are allowed to worship in the Muslim lands, according certainly to the teaching of Imam Malik, Rabbi Ma'am, and Abu Hanifa, and they are not to be coerced into becoming Muslims, and they are allowed to maintain their churches, synagogues, and temples, places of worship, and to teach their children their religion, and they have a protected status, which is called Ahlul Zimmah, the people of protection, and they're to be protected by the Muslims in protecting their right to worship, their understanding of the divine as they see fit, whether it involves idols or not. But the actual place of Mecca and Medina is to be freed of any adulteration, of any change, of any, and this is why during the time of Omar radiallahu anhu, there was the two places were completely purified of any deen other than Islam. And it's only, unfortunately, recently that the state religion of Islam has crept back and caused the damage that it had. So. Any other question or comment people have? The call? This is called the Adhan, and basically 5 times a day, or 6 times if you have the morning prayer, which in some countries they have 2, an early morning, and which is before dawn and then a dawn time. The call to the prayer is made, 5 prayers, and it's interesting that traditions have ways of calling their people to prayer. The traditional Christian way is by the bell. The traditional Jewish way is by a ram's horn. Some of the Buddhists use trumpets, and other Buddhists use the triangular. I'm not sure what it's called. I can't remember. What's that called? There's a little triangle of metal that you hit, and they'll use that. But it is Islam that uses the human voice to call, because we are a logocentric tradition. Our teaching is based on the word. It's based on communication, which is linguistic. And so our call to worship is through language. In the same way that traditionally there is no symbol of Islam. Like Christianity takes the symbol of the cross, and Judaism takes the symbol of the two triangles, one inverted upon the other, and Buddhism takes the symbol of the wheel of Dharma, that religious tradition. Now sometimes the Seljuk Hilal, or crescent moon, is used as a symbol for Islam. This is actually an innovation. It is not from the Islamic tradition, but it's nonetheless interesting to note that the Seljuks did take a natural symbol, a symbol from the natural world, to symbolize the nature of the natural teaching of Islam, that it is not supposed to be an artificially created teaching, therefore it should not have an artificially created symbol to represent it, but rather a natural symbol. So that it is the human voice through which God calls human beings. And this is why the Quran includes the language of human beings, which is Arabic, and that is how people are called. So this is saying first that Allah is greater than anything that can be conceived. Allahu Akbar. Allah is greater than any conception. Allah is greater than anything, laysa kamithlihi shay, and then that there is no God but Allah, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has become his messenger, which in that articulation is the exceptions of all the previous messengers as well. According to Imam al-Tirmidhi, the hadith says that there were 124,000 prophets to human beings, that every people had a prophet, and it is our belief that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is unique in that he is a prophet to all people, as opposed to previous prophets who were limited given the nature of the provincial nature of the world prior to the time of the Prophet Muhammad, when communities were very isolated. And then that Hayya ala Salah, which is come to prayer, Hayya ala Salah, which is come to success, and then again Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and then that Allah, there's no God but Allah. So that's basically what that call entails, and that we have impending prayer to perform as well for all the Asia. What's that? Oh, right. Just that there is a sacrifice that people are encouraged, and not only the people making the pilgrimage, but also the people here at the various places where the pilgrims have left from are encouraged to sacrifice an animal to be, and it's to feed the poor, and also one third for the family, one third for one's friends, and a third for the poor, was the traditional division. Now, I think it's important to note here also that traditionally human beings ate very little meat. This is quite well established in any books on nutrition. Meat was actually considered a very excessive food. The word in Arabic for gout is called da'un muruk, which means the disease of chains, because those were the people that got to eat meat all the time, and that's how you got gout. And so really, unfortunately now, Muslims, like many people, overconsume grossly. During the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab, he prohibited meat to be eaten more than once every other day for wealthy people. And he did that because he did not feel that it was good that the society should have divisions of people where people were eating meat a lot and other people weren't. And there's a tradition where Umar was brought some sweets from Persia, and when he saw them, he said, does everybody in Persia, because the man who brought it was a governor from Persia, he said, does everybody eat this? He said, oh, no, 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 only the affluent people eat that. And he said, well, then I don't want any. And he was simply establishing the idea of justice, that when you have gratuitous consumption, by the very nature of gratuitous consumption, you will always have people consuming a lot and people who tend to be consumed by the consumers. And this is why probably more than any other time, certainly in our Western Hemisphere, we are literally consuming what's been termed the third world, that people go without there so that people can have much, much more here. And so part of the idea of Hajj is that there was a sacrifice of meat in which poor people in the community were allowed to eat meat as a gift, as a celebration and a gift. And going back to Ibrahim and the dhabih of his that he was given when he was told in his dream to sacrifice his son, and then in fulfilling that, he was given a kish or a huge ram in the place of the sacrifice of his son. So it's symbolic of the covenant with God that Abraham made, and his absolute and total submission to God, as one of the greatest tests of any prophet given was that test. And the Quran calls it, that is the great test that Ibrahim was given, and he fulfilled his state of submission, and so God exchanged the test with a ram, and so it's symbolic of our connection with Abraham as well, and with the Abrahamic tradition. So that's... The black stone is called the Yamin al-Lat al-Arm in the Hadith, which I don't want to use anthropomorphic terms, but Yameen traditionally means in Arabic the right hand, and certainly we in no way believe that that God has any anthropomorphic qualities or human-like qualities, but it is symbolic of the going to the house of the king. And kissing the throne is, the closest human analogy would be like kissing the hand of one's king or one's master. It's an honor. Of course, that would be if the king was just. Otherwise, it would be a humiliation. One of the names of God in the Quran is Al-Adl, which means the just. And so we believe that God is just, and so it's an honor to kiss the hand of a just king in the worldly life, and it is symbolic simply of that, of an honor that God has bestowed upon human beings. To kiss the black stone, it was believed initially that, and there are some traditions that state that it came from the heavens or was thrust out of Jannah, of paradise, and the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, placed it in the corner of the Kaaba. It's one of the great stories of his pre-Islamic period before he was given the revelation, when the Quraysh rebuilt the house according to the foundations, and they were arguing, the different tribes, the different branches of the Quraysh were arguing about who would have the honor of placing the black stone, and they decided that they would allow the first person who entered into the haram to decide for them, and the first person happened to be the Prophet Muhammad, Muhammad Amin, and this is a confirmed story by even the people that were rejected, enemies of Islam. And when he came in, he told them to bring a cloth, and they brought a cloth, and he had it spread out, and then he placed the rock on the cloth, and he had all the tribes lift up the cloth. So each one would share in the elevating of the stone, and then he himself placed the stone in its place. And they all said, رَبِّنَا بِالْأَمِينَ آسِمَا, we are content with the trustworthy one as the one who divides or decides. And so, or hakima. And so the Prophet did that, and we're encouraged to go around the Kaaba and kiss the black stone. And also in the tradition it was said that it was originally white in its purity and was darkened with the wrong actions of people that touched it. Allahu alam, and that also should not in any way denote the idea of racial superiority, like in some traditions, in the Hindu tradition, you have the varna system, which is the class system, and varna means color in Sanskrit, and the highest people are the Aryan Brahmins, who are the light skin, and the lowest people are the Shudra, who are the Dasa, the Dravidian people, who were the traditional black people of India. There's no, and I actually checked this with some of my Nigerian friends from Kano, people from the Hausa and the Fulani, and I asked them if they had metaphors in their language about black and white being pure and impure, and they said, oh yes, we say he has a black heart. And the Fulani and the Hausa are very, very dark people. So the metaphor in no way should be seen as a metaphor of skin color, but rather simply of the idea of something that you can't see dirt on it. And white, you can tell if there's dirt, and black, you can't. And so it's the idea of simply that, and has nothing to do with the racial connotations that people have derived from those things using these metaphors. So, is that from the last one, I think. Okay. Yeah. No, I was just being a little facetious about, there's been an institutionalization of Islam in which oppressive powers have co-opted the names of Islam and use it to oppress people. And so I'm talking about the state religion of Islam, where you have states that are oppressive and tyrannical, and they use religion as a means of legitimizing their tyranny. That's what I'm talking about. The Shia and the Sunni?
Yeah, at least.
Yeah, the difference between the Shiites and the Sunni are about 85 to 90% of the Muslim world, and the Shia represent around anywhere between 12 to 8%, and mostly centered in the southern region of Iraq and in Persia and in some of the southern Russian areas, what used to be Russia, and then in Bahrain, Kuwait, and these places. Is where you find, and the basic difference is simply that it's a political difference. It's the differences in there are some differences in beliefs, but really that we do believe. Like I was trained in the Sunni tradition, and we believe that that the Shia are Muslims. We disagree with some of their understanding. And likewise, the Isma'ashariya, or the dominant Shia group, which is called the Twelvers, as opposed to the Isma'iliyas, who are called the Seveners. The Twelvers, that is the dominant Shiite group, also consider the Sunnis to be Muslims. So we do agree at that level. We disagree on some political issues about revolting against oppressive governments, and about also the position of Bani Hashim in terms of ascendancy, political ascendancy. The same Quran. They have the same Quran. We differ on our Hadith tradition, which is the prophetic traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.